Our first speaker will be Bonnie Snyder. Dean of Arcourt, New York.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Happy and glad to be here and to testify to the things that I've learned in the school. And it's been a little bit of a long trip. We've had a wonderful time so far, and I'm sure it's going to continue. I would like to go to the last couple verses in the scripture and continue thou on the things that thou hast learned. Because really what I'd like to talk about is some of the things that we've learned.
All right.
Continue that with the things that I was learning.
14. But continue thou with the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of knowing of whom thou hast learned them.
Okay, and so he's admonishing them to continue in the things that they have learned. And I'd just like to address, in the short time that I have, some of the things that I've learned since coming down here. And one of the things that I've learned, let's go to John 17 and 3, please. And also, I think it's 1 Peter
17. And the man of Yahweh may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
John 17 and 3.
And this is life eternal, that they may know that thou art the true El, thou art the only true El, and Yahshua Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
Okay. Now this is what life eternal is. And really, if you think about this, this school really is for the inner man. And that's something we need to understand right away. It's not about the outward, whatever we are, what our job is, what our family life is. It's really addressing the inner man. So we need to think about that, maybe for the first time in our life. See? And it wasn't. Was that John 17 and 3?
And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou only art the true El and Yahshua Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
Okay. I'm having a hard time here. I'm not sure why. All right. Anyway, you can know Yahweh. And that's one of the things that we really would like to address. All right, let's skip maybe Romans 1, 19 and 20, go there. Here's, I want the verse, knowing this first and no prophecy of the scripture.
Oh, that's 2 Peter.
2 Peter, okay.
Romans 1, 19 and 20.
Thank you.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Now look it. Just think about the way these things are written too. That which may be known of Yahweh, you can know something about him. And this teaching really is the only place in the whole world where you can find out something about Yahweh. And I know that that's a really bold statement, but we can prove that it's just that way. You understand? Go ahead and read that again.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is
manifest. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest. And manifest means shown. That which may be known of Yahweh is shown unto them. You can show, and these pictorial illustrations of what is written in your Bible, because the Bible came from vision, a vision and a revelation, you understand? That's how you can look at it, or that's how it's shown. So that which may be known and you can know, read.
For Yahweh hath showed it unto them.
Read.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
See, because Yahweh, he is invisible. He's spirit. And if you think about this, get John 4, 24, please. And John 1 and 1. And I know I've got a couple things out there. But...
John 4, 24. Yahweh is spirit.
Now Yahweh is spirit. And spirit is attributes, wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. That's what Yahweh is. He's attributes. All right? Now John 1 and 1, please.
In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with Yahweh.
The Word was with Yahweh. Read.
And the Word was Yahweh.
This Word is these attributes taken out of shape and form.
That's
read.
Right.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Read, please.
All things were made by Him.
This is your Creator. He's the one that made all things. Read.
And without Him was not anything made that was And the life was the light of men.
Okay, read 14, please.
And the word was made flesh.
So these attributes that have taken on shape and form came right down in the physical body, and the word was made flesh. And it also came in as Yahshua the Messiah. The word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Read.
And we beheld his glory.
Uh-huh.
The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, through grace and truth.
Okay, go back to Romans, please.
Well, the invisible things of him.
Now, this is something that's invisible. The invisible things of him. Read.
From the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Read.
Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
So you can understand how Yahweh exists as a unity. You understand? And you don't have an excuse for not knowing it either, because it's understood by the things that are made. And one of the things that's made is this tabernacle pattern right here. And it was really Yahweh Elohim takes on shape and form. He transmutes himself into a threefold, intangible tabernacle pattern up here in the wilderness, or up here on Mount Sinai. And then he instructs Moses to build it in the wilderness of Sinai. So you have this tabernacle pattern, which is a reflection of him. It has a most holy place, court roundabout. It's one, two, three, yet it's one tabernacle. It shows you how Yahweh's one spirit takes on shape and form, and then comes into the flesh. This is this way because he's that way. You understand? And this shows how he exists. This is really the pattern of him. And this is an invisible thing, but yet you can see it by how he broke it down here in the wilderness. And really what Romans 1:19 and 20 tells you is you need a witness. Because this is the witness that's showing you how he exists. All right, let's get John 5, please. 30, John 5 and 30, or just.
39, right?
Yeah, John 5 and 39.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me.
Okay, so this is Yahshua the Messiah speaking. Remember, this is Yahweh, takes on shape and form, takes on a body. This is what he's talking about. And that's one thing that, you know, it's hard to even get it together to explain it sometimes. And the reason why is, it's this great thing that we see, we understand that Yahweh himself, the one that created everything, comes into a body, and he's got something to say. And he says it the way that he means it. You understand? And you have the self same thing. Stay where you are, Joel. Okay. Somebody else give me that 1 Peter that I wanted, or 2 Peter, whatever.
2 Peter 1:19.
Read.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Read.
Whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first.
Now look it. Peter's saying, knowing this first.
Come on, girl.
Read.
That no prophecy of the scripture.
That no prophecy of the scripture.
Is,
or no testifying of any scripture. No teaching about any of the scripture. Read.
Is of any private interpretation.
It's not a private thing. Read.
For the prophecy came not in old time.
This is how the prophecy came. This is how the books of your Bible came, from Moses to Revelation. This is how this book came. Read.
For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man.
It didn't come by the will of man. Right. Somebody didn't decide, I want to learn all about God, and I'll learn all about him, and I'll write down what I think. I could do that. I could sit there and dream up and write down whatever I wanted. But that's not the way that thus saith Yahweh, through the Holy Spirit. Read.
But holy men of Yahweh.
Holy men of Yahweh. And just for some of you that have been around here a long time, he called them holy men. He didn't call them demons back there.
There you go.
Holy men of Yahweh.
That's right.
Spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
Spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. So when you're reading out of your Bible, that's why we can go to the Bible. When you're reading out of the Bible, it is what is coming right from the Creator. That's why it's important to listen. And you might not like the deliverer, but you ought to like what's being delivered. Because it's what they'll say in the Yahweh if it's proven. You understand? All right, so let's go back to where you were, please, Joe.
40 verse. But you will not come unto me that you might have life.
Uh-huh.
I receive not honor from men.
This is the Messiah speaking. You listen to what the Messiah's got to say. I receive not honor from men.
Right.
Oh, that's something else.
Right.
That's something else. Mm-hmm. Read.
But I know you,
uh-huh,
that you have not the love of Elohim in you.
Mm-hmm.
I am come in
you
my
know
Father's
how
name.
Because they were receiving honor of men.
That's right. That's right.
Read.
I am come in my Father's name,
mm-hmm,
and you receive me not.
Read.
Let another come in his own name, him you will receive.
And see, Yahweh is the name of the Father. Yahshua comes in the Father's name.
That's right.
His name is Yahweh. Yah is salvation. I am come, and this is what he's saying.
Right.
And you can find out in any old dictionary that the name's Yahweh. You understand? And you can talk to Hebrews, or you can talk to a Christian minister, and you can find out that that's what the name is. And then you go to your Bible, and he says, I am come in my Father's name. You ought to know what that name is. He said it. I'm come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. And if you look at do we have Jesus on here? Yeah, right here. This is a name that's been received.
Right.
You understand? This is a name. I wasn't hard. Anyway, read.
How can you believe which receive honor one of another,
uh-huh,
and seek not the honor that cometh from Elohim only?
Read.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Mm-hmm.
There is one that accused you, even Moses, in whom you trust.
So back here in Moses, okay, read.
For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me,
uh-huh,
for he wrote of me.
See, so Moses wrote about the Messiah. And I'm just going to take one little thing, the Lamb of Yahweh down in here, and show you how, something about that, all right? So what you have down here, see, this is out of the book of Exodus, this whole migration of the children of Israel here. And what you had down here, before the children of Israel could leave Egypt, there had to be the death of a lamb, all right? Now that lamb was going to die so that Israel could be delivered up. Well, first of all, the lamb had to die so that the death angel would pass over. You understand? So the lamb died to save them from death. So the Messiah comes in, and this is pointing him out. All your witnesses, everything that was written. Do you know what? The entire creation that he's made. Sometimes you might sit and wonder to yourself, I wonder why this creation is here. I wonder why I'm here. You might wonder something.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder why the Bible was written the way it was. Everything was done. The creation was made. The Bible was, the events in the Bible happened, all to point out your Savior, Yahshua the Messiah. This whole thing was done to point him out. All right? So anyway, you have this lamb here, which is going to point out Yahshua the Messiah. So you have the death of that lamb there, and the reason why he died. And this is another thing. This lamb that died down here, he had no spot and blemish. He was a special lamb.
Right.
He did not have sin on him. It pointed out how Yahshua the Messiah was going to be that lamb without spot, without blemish. Because you read these things in your Bible, you read how the Messiah, this is what we're used to. Looking at him here, we're saying that's the Messiah died, you understand? But we don't know how. We don't know in what name. We don't know why he did it. But you can learn how he did it down here. There was a reason. And all you have to do is go back to the witnesses and look at them. And this lamb died back here so that the children of Israel could be saved from death and then delivered up out of Egypt. They had to take out that Passover lamb for deliverance. There was going to be a salvation manifest there. You understand? All right, so that you have that there. You have John pointing out Yahshua the Messiah as the Lamb of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
All right? He's pointed out as a lamb. Well, if you look back here, and also in your tabernacle pattern, you had a lamb that was killed 2 times a day. Morning and evening sacrifices, day by day, every day. You understand? And then when they got when they came through the migration and they came into the mountain, there was a temple made, and there was even more sacrifices. So 40 years in the wilderness, day by day. Is that just about a lot of blood? Yes, it is. It's showing you what a great sacrifice that really was. That and he's pointed out as the Lamb of Yahweh, isn't that right? Which taketh away the sin of the world. You have here with Abraham and Isaac, and I know it's not on the chart, might be right here someplace, but you have Abraham and Isaac, and he, let's go ahead and get this, Genesis 22.
And it came to pass, that after these things, that Elohim did prove Abraham, and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, Take now thy son.
Take now your son.
Thy only son, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains.
So Abraham, go offer up your son. And you read through there, Abraham was obedient, he went to offer up his son. You can even read in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, all right? That he went and he offered him up, all right? So then, jump down there where a ram was caught in the thicket instead.
Hebrews, verse 7. And Isaac spake unto Abraham and his father, said, My father. And he says, Here I am, my son. And he said, Behold the fire and the wood. But where is the lamb for a burnt offering?
Okay, so he's told to offer him up, and Isaac's questioning him, the wood, and where's the sacrifice?
Right.
Read.
And Abraham said, My son, Elohim will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering.
Read.
So they went, both of them, together. And they came to the place which Elohim had told of him, and Abraham built an altar there, and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac, his son.
So he was going to offer him up. Read.
And Abraham laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of Yahweh called unto him out of heavens, out of the heavens, and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he says, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad.
Okay, neither so he stayed his hand, read.
Neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest Elohim. See, thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only, from me.
Okay. And do you have the ram caught in the thicket?
And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns.
Okay, look it. There was a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. That ram was pointing to Yahshua the Messiah. He died instead of Isaac. That's showing us over and over again, and there's many more witnesses, how that something dies. A lamb dies here, lamb, you know, he's pointing out the lamb. Lamb dies every day, twice a day. It's pointing out that when Yahshua the Messiah comes in, he's going to die. And he's going to die for somebody.
Right.
He's not going to die for himself.
That's right.
You understand? He's going to die for somebody. Because the witnesses show that he died for somebody. That's what a lamb shows you. The lamb took on the sin of the people. Even back in the tabernacle, the wages of sin back here was death. You understand? So that if the lamb that died took on the sin, then they'd be forgiven for another year. On the Day of Atonement, let's say. Or even day by day. Every day is a Day of Atonement. You see what I mean? It is, every day. So anyway, it's pointing out Yahshua the Messiah and how he was the one. Let's get First Timothy 1:15. And Matthew 1:21.
1 Timothy 1:15. This is a faithful saying.
Because you know, Yahshua the Messiah did have a so-called mission when he came into the world. There was a reason why he came. He was going to accomplish something.
Yeah.
He didn't just come down here for no good reason. He came all the way down. You think about somebody that's got the power to speak into creation. You understand? And make everything work exactly the way that it does.
Right.
Folks, you are your own witness. Everything about you works. Do you understand how you physically saw everything about you works? You came out that way. And some spirit or something causes that to happen. That's the one whom we have to do in here. Go ahead, read.
And worthy of all acceptance.
Okay, we just start again.
This is a faithful saying.
Now this is a faithful saying, and this is Peter, Paul writing to Timothy, I believe it was. And Paul has the Holy Spirit, and that's another thing. You want to know what the Holy Spirit, how he thinks? Go to your scriptures.
Right.
You don't have to go to a man to find out something about the Holy Spirit. You need to go to your scriptures, because that's how the way Yahweh set it up. Go ahead and read.
And worthy of all acceptance.
This is a faithful saying, and it's worthy of you accepting this. See, you need to know why the Messiah came in. Read.
That Yahshua the Messiah came into the world to save sinners.
Yahshua the Messiah came into this world to save sinners. He came in the world to be salvation. And his name proves that. He came in so that Yahweh would save. Yahweh, the one that made everything, comes into shape and form, comes into the flesh, and takes on the sin of the whole world. Just like the lamb took on the sin back here, this one took on everybody's sin, on himself. Mm-hmm. He came into the world to save sinners. Read, please.
Of whom I am chief.
Read.
Howbeit for this cause I obtain mercy.
Mm-hmm. Because he did this, because sometimes we just forget about this cross business. Because Yahshua the Messiah came in and did this, he obtained mercy, Paul. Mm-hmm. And you know what? He needed it. And so do you.
Yeah.
That's why he obtained it. You understand? Read.
That in me first, Yahshua the Messiah might show forth all long suffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting.
Okay, let's get, Matthew 1 and 21.
And she shall bring forth a son.
And look at, this is when Yahshua the Messiah is being born into the world. Angel comes, names that baby, and she shall have a son. And you know what? Most of us didn't know. I mean, now they do because they look inside there.
Right.
But they didn't know it back then. There was no way for her to know it unless somebody told her. And she shall bring forth the son. Read.
And thou shalt call his name Yahshua.
And you know what? If they knew the scriptures even before she had conceived, that's a male lamb back there that had to be taken out of the flock. So you know it had to be a male. Wasn't going to be a girl savior.
Right.
That's right. Read. And she shall bring forth the son. Read.
For he shall save the people, his people from his sin, from their sins.
You shall call his name Yahshua. Let's do this real quick. You're going to call his name Yahshua. Yahweh, because that's what Yahshua means. Yahshua. You're going to call his name Yahshua. Yahweh is salvation. Yahshua, colon, this is going to explain why you're going to call his name Yahshua. Read.
For he shall save his people from their sins.
For he shall save.
Right.
He's going to save his people from their sins. He's going to be the lamb. He's going to take all our sins on him. And he did it according to the scriptures. You understand? And that was a big thing, folks. And it's something to put your faith and confidence in. With those few words of encouragement, I hope somebody got something.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I thank Yahweh Elohim, Yahshua Messiah, for allowing me to visit the brethren in the Ontario Branch School. I send greetings and love from the brethren in West Virginia, Jamaica, Bahamas, the other brethren. I came into school some years ago. I was the only white guy in the place. And they said a black man had a vision revelation here in 1931, but he said, don't believe me. Make me prove it to your satisfaction. You're not obligated to believe it. It was black people teaching. It wasn't black people teaching me. It was the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And the Holy Spirit ain't got no color. The truth ain't got no color. Knowledge ain't got no color.
Right.
But in this school, we're going to teach, you're going to hear things, and we prove, he proves what he says, because Dr. Kinley said what really happened, he received Yahshua the Messiah. And really, if this thing's delivered properly, it is Yahshua the Messiah speaking to you right now.
That's
not
right.
Something back there. See, what that angel declared, she just left off in Matthew 1:21, that thou shalt call his name Yahshua, for he shall save his people from their sin. See, Yahweh had that purpose in pure spirit.
Yeah.
That he was going to be salvation.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
That name's from everlasting to everlasting.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
See, and that's why you can't use Jesus. Because that wasn't the name.
Right.
Watch this. This is how simple it is. And this shows you how good a lion spirit is. The letter J is only 400 years old. Savior died 2,000 years ago. Impossible for his name to be Jesus. Impossible. No way. There's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. 26 in the English. No letter J in Hebrew. He was a born Hebrew. Impossible for his name to be Jesus. Now you talk about an imagination. And the whole world running after him. There's 1 billion Roman Catholics believe in the Pope of Rome, who more or less put that in the Bible. Okay? Another 1 billion Christians. Why are so many people wrong? Because Yahshua said it, Matthew 24:11. Many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. People might think we're the ones. Oh, no. You can go to the oldest scriptures in the world, and this is there. Yahweh. His name, Yahweh. Mm-hmm. You understand? Mm-hmm. And so Yahweh declared he would be salvation, not some man-made name later on. You got the Creator dying for the sin of the world, and you're to give him some other man's name and say that's salvation too? See, it's just like the golden calf. Yahweh gave the name to Moses at the burning bush, said, this is my name forever, Exodus 3:15. That don't change, said throughout all generations. Came down here and delivered the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. And as a matter of fact, in Exodus 9:16, because it talked about power in the scripture lesson a little bit, in 2 Timothy 3:5, it says, having a form of worship, but denying the power thereof. Mm-hmm. People say, name don't matter. You're denying the power. Because in Exodus 9:16, it said, in this very deed did I raise you up. Yeah. I might show forth my power, and my name might be declared to the altar. It was that name and the power of it that delivered children of Israel. And it was so powerful, it was declared. Because when they went over to Canaan's land, we heard about you. We heard how you destroyed Egypt. You know what I'm saying? And the people, Yahweh, you better leave them alone. You understand? And that girl was a harlot. And she turned around and said, you need help? You understand? And changed. And she wasn't no harlot no more. That's what people don't realize. She didn't keep playing it. That's showing Yahweh turned you around. See, but even after they were delivered, what'd they do? Build a golden calf and let this be the God. Now that's an imagination. Right. And it ain't. And you said, boy, they built a golden calf. I can't believe it. Well, Jesus is a golden calf in your mind.
Very good.
Until this teaching. That's an imagination. It ain't no different. Because Jesus is an imagination. You are imagining that's your Savior's name. You can't prove it. You can disagree with what we say down here, but you can't disprove none of this. We ain't playing down here. A vision revelation means it's directly from the Heavenly Father. See, from a natural standpoint, if you don't have natural vision, you can't see nothing natural. If you don't have spiritual vision, you ain't seeing nothing spiritual.
Very good.
That's why we're talking about this school here. This is the Creator giving you something so you can see something. So we're saying salvation was purposed back here, and when he came forth, he's declaring salvation.
Very good.
And the whole creation is preaching salvation. And that's why when they come up out of the land of Egypt in Exodus 14:13, it says, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh. So why don't you stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh by coming down to this school? You know what I'm saying? Salvation of Yahweh is Yahshua. See, you understand? That is, Yahshua means Yahweh is salvation. Now that's in the law. See, in Isaiah 8:20, it says, to the law and to the testimony. They speak not according to this word, there's no light in it. You ain't no Holy Spirit in you, you can't prove what you say, go in the first 5 books of your Bible, the next 34.
That's right.
You can't, and see, that's why Yahshua had to come, when Yahshua said he come to fulfill, you better see a man named Yahshua in the institution. And he said that, you know, because he's fulfilled it. And there ain't no man called Jesus back here. Matter of fact, in John 5:46, it said, if you believe Moses, you believe me, for Moses wrote of me. Moses ain't writing no Jesus. He wrote one called Joshua, but there ain't no letter J. So it ain't Joshua, it's Yahshua. And matter of fact, his name was Yahoshua, which means Yahweh will be salvation. But when he comes in and does the death, burial, resurrection, sends out the Holy Spirit, it's Yahweh is salvation.
All right.
You understand? See, that O is future perfect in Hebrew. We ain't playing down here. You understand? Mm-hmm. And I was a fool in a pair of shoes. I come down. I didn't know what was in the Bible. I learned everything sitting down in a seat. And that's the way everybody got to come. Ain't nobody's no better than the next one. See, but you know what? You have to admit Hey, I was deceived. I was lied to. You know what I'm saying? Ain't nobody. You know what? You know, high priest couldn't eat no bread if he stood up, because the bread was only 27 inches. It was only 27 inch high. He'd starve himself. You got to bow to eat Yahweh's bread. You have to come down and get some food. You understand? Now, when you go in the prophets, Jonah 2 and 9, it says, I bow the voice of thanksgiving. Salvation is of Yahweh, Yahshua. And that's when Yahweh spake to the fish and let him go. You know what I'm saying? It was spit out on the earth. And he made a 3-day journey. He's walking in there on the first day. That's a quick day spirit, ain't it? He might want to go the wrong way, but y'all ain't made him go the right way. You understand? Mm-hmm. He can turn you around. So the angel in the fulfillment says, so that salvation is of Yahweh in the law and the prophets. See? And then you got, and when you look in Numbers 13 and 8 and 16, it'll say it called Hoshea, the son of Nun, Yahoshua. And if you got a good study Bible, it'll say Savior. So we ain't making nothing up. We just tell you like it straight is. IS is. That's pretty easy. Anyway. So then when the angel, quote, says his name, and see, the angel's coming by vision giving the name Yahshua. Why? Because it's fulfilling that the angel gave the name of Yahweh by vision back there with Moses. The name Yahweh. See, they didn't know it all. Matter of fact, it says, someone said, I don't believe that. Well, see, he didn't say I am that I am. He said, I Yah. Asher, Ayah. And really, Asher is an infinite. Asher means a lot of things. It means I will be what I will to be, I will be who I will to be, I will be where I will to be, I will be because I will to be, I will be as I will to be. You understand? I will be whatsoever I will to be, I will be wheresoever I will. It don't. Whensoever. Now that's an infinite statement. Showing forth you can't put no limits on Yahweh. You understand? See, that's why he can take us from Michigan and New York and West Virginia and put us in a van all the way across. It's a unity of the spirit.
Very good.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And don't matter what color I are, truth's good for everybody, every man's soul. You know what? You look at our souls, they'd be the same color. You know what I'm saying? And you got a heel on your soul. And heel spelled H-E-E-L. Heel, you have to know Yahweh, Heel. And then you know Yahshua Messiah healed people from a physical standpoint to show he can heal you from a spiritual standpoint. And you spell that heel, H-E-A-L. Why? Because he all too. And you have to know that. And you think he's separate from everything. You understand? Really, you ain't existing without him. Matter of fact, Yahweh means he who exists and causes to exist. You ain't existing separate from him. You have to come down here and find out really who you are.
There you go.
You understand? Because you can't come separate from him.
That's right.
There ain't nothing separate from him. That's why he giveth all life. And that's why you can't change Yahweh, who's masculine and feminine,
right,
to Lord. Because that's male only.
Yeah.
Mm. And Elohim means, El means almighty. That is Yahweh, so it's still the same thing. See? And almighty him, and just keeping the masculine, being the son. But God, every God needs a goddess, every Lord needs a lady. These are both masculine. That's man with man having a son. That ain't never gonna happen. Man with man can't do that. We could show you some hidden things in there too. Look at Lord. Lucifer or devil. Doesn't change Yahweh's name. Something else, ain't it? And here you can say, go, devil. Cheerleader. But anyway. And I tell you what, I can show you 666 with that. See, people don't know. We don't play. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Lord, go.
Okay.
D, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. D, Jesus got 6 letters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's 666. That ain't his name. And you know, they'll say, he got many names. You're speaking about the wrong one. Because you go to Revelation 20, when it says, his tail drew a one-third, well, no, Revelation 12, it said he was cast out. The dragon was cast out. Uh-huh. That old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole. Who's got the many titles and name? He does. So anytime you say who got the many names and titles, that's the devil. That ain't Yahweh.
That's why you got 1 billion Muslims. A guy comes 500 years after Yahshua Dabbery resurrected and writes a Koran and got 1 billion falling after many false prophets, shall arise and shall deceive many. Many. Don't be thinking this a little bitty down here. It's the many. And we ain't false. We're telling you the truth. See, and I didn't know this before. So we bow. We're taking away, but we're giving you the right thing. See, and after his death, burial, resurrection, somebody say, name don't matter. And you tell me in Matthew 28:18 why he said, all power is given me in heaven and earth. Mm-hmm. Go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing in the name. Now, why would he tell them to baptize in the name if name don't matter? So you ain't thinking. Baptize in the name, not water. It says name. Baptize in the name of Father Yahweh, Son Elohim, Holy Spirit Yahshua. You've just been baptized in the name. And teaching them to observe all things, whatsoever I said unto you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. They say, gone away, come back. Then he ascended and poured out the Holy Spirit. When he poured out the Holy Spirit, they said they began to speak with other tongues. The Spirit gave us utterance. That's why we speak, we don't speak like everybody.
Very good.
You understand?
Yeah.
And then when they healed the man, we talked about power, didn't we? Matter of fact, you read Isaiah 33:6, it'll say, knowledge and wisdom shall be the stability of thy times, the strength of thy salvation. Dr. Kinley said, that ain't the way it is now. Why? Because knowledge and wisdom, that was when Isaiah was prophesying before the Holy Spirit was poured out. Knowledge and wisdom shall be the stability of times. But after his death, burial, resurrection, outpouring of the Holy Spirit, knowledge and wisdom is the stability of times and the strength of thy salvation. Because it's up to date. He was saying shall back here 700 years before the Savior comes in. But now it is. It was there about 600 years. Whatever. You know. Okay. Now, it also says in Proverbs 18:21, death and life shall be in power of the tongue. Death and life, there's power in the tongue of death and life. How's that? Because if you're lying to somebody, it's going to damn somebody's soul. If you're speaking the truth to them, that's going to save their soul. See? Okay, I'm just running power a little bit here, okay? Go John 10:17. Yahshua said, I have the power. No man taking my life. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it up again. Okay? Then you read John 17:4, or 17:2, said he, Yahweh had given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as the Father gave me. Now, if you got power over all flesh, you tell me why them slaveholders were using Lord God and Jesus and didn't know that you don't treat a man like an animal and don't pay him nothing. Huh? Huh? Why did Jesus tell him that if he had power over all flesh? His name's Joshua. And we ain't playing that game now. You understand? Every man has a soul to be saved. Don't matter what your skin color is, how much money you got in your pocket, and where the country you come from. See? So after his death, burial, resurrection, and they healed that man in the third chapter, just in the name of Yahshua, rise and walk. That man was leaping and happy, you understand? They got mad about it. Yeah. And then they got them ready to put them in. They was grieved that they was preaching Yahshua and the resurrection. Grieved that he resurrected. That's in the first verse of chapter 4. Then the seventh verse, they got him in jail. They surround him. By what power, what name did you do this? Must be power in the name, huh? And in Acts 4:10, it says, be it known unto y'all that Yahshua the Messiah, whom you crucified, whom Yahweh raised from the dead, does this man stand before you whole? This is the stone which you builders have rejected, but now become the head of the corner. And Acts 4:12 is everybody's Bible. Neither is there salvation in any other. There's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now, before you come to class, you might have had a Jesus there. But now you're here in Yahshua. You better choose this day which one's right. And I don't care how much you done praying and got some things happen to you. But that's in Matthew 15:26. What's the profit of man? 16:26. What's the profit of man if he gained the whole world but lose his soul? What happens if you prayed for something, you got something physical, but your soul be damned because you're believing a lie? And Isaiah 49:5 says, I girded you though you didn't know me. You understand? He took care of you when you didn't know his name. But like Dr. Kinley said, after we tell you the name, it's your last night you saved in it. In Jesus. Because you were told the truth. And that's why in Philippians 2 and 9, it says, wherefore Yahweh has highly exalted his son and given him a name, one name, that's above every name, the name of Yahshua. Every knee shall bow in heaven and earth under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Yahshua is the Savior to the glory of Yahweh. Now, if you don't want to confess it now, you will in the lake of fire, because he said every tongue will confess it. Every tongue. And you can go to Matthew 10:32, and it says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. He said, you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father. Serious thing, we ain't playing with you. So what we see is this. It was Yahshua. You know when the angels was cast out? He said, now has come salvation. Yahweh is salvation. You understand? Then you got it in the prop, it's all what you know. Yahweh is salvation, Exodus 14:13. Then Jonah 2 and 9, we're just running all the way down there. Before he's born, that was Matthew 1:21. Shall call his name Yahshua, he shall save his people from their sins. Then he died, buried, resurrected, pours out the Holy Spirit. See, that's what people don't realize. That didn't stop him. He resurrected a quickening spirit, ascended and poured out the Holy Spirit. Well, watch this quick. Just hold on. Poured out the Holy Spirit. Yahshua is the name here. And now we're down here. And some man declaring the same thing that began at the beginning of the age. The Holy Spirit was, matter of fact, here, the Gentiles who had never had the old covenant.
Yeah.
Peter by vision. Cornelius has a vision. Go down and get that man down there called Peter. He's going to tell you what's going on. And Peter has a vision. Spirit tells him, three men coming there. Go with them, doubting nothing.
Right.
He don't like the Gentiles.
Right.
And he gets out there in Acts 10:34. He said, I see Yahweh, no respect for persons.
Uh-huh.
And you know what he did? He preached the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah according to the law and the prophets in the name of Yahshua. And as he spoke those words, the Holy Spirit fell on them that heard the word. Gift. You understand? You ain't getting no different down here. See, you understand? It's the same thing. See, and then this man had a vision revelation. He was wrong for 35 years of his life. Just like Paul was wrong. Yahweh turned him around, give him the right thing. That's what happened to this man. And that's really what's happened to everyone that's sitting here
that's
got the right Holy Spirit. He got to turn you around and show you the right thing. And you should be eternally thankful for that. Get Ephesians 1:21. To show you that we're going to show you that it's in this age and the one to come. So that name will take you on over. So we're showing you it's Yahshua or Yahweh's salvation from eternity to eternity or from everlasting to everlasting. Read. You might as well get Revelation 2 and 17.
Ephesians 1:21. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion. And every name that is named,
see,
not only
Yahshua,
in this age.
Yahshua is above every name that is named. You know, just like today, they was looking for Jesus. He done escaped from the prison or something. I don't know, they were, did something.
That was Jesus.
Same thing, they spelled Jesus. It's the same spelling.
Right.
See, what they did, all them Spanish people done copied the name. That's what, when they say Jesus Christos, they're saying Jesus, same name. That's what the Spanish call Jesus. They're naming their sons after him. That's why Yahweh allowed them to change the name, because your son ain't Jesus. Your son ain't the Savior. Matter of fact, a lot of them's criminals. Well, that one was. It was on TV. And they're looking for Jesus. Everybody is looking for Jesus. Where is Jesus at? Can't find him. Because he don't exist. And shoot, them people in Florida, them holiness people, you know how they pray and say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus? Then they all come over in ships from Cuba. Anyway. He came. His name's Joshua, not Jesus. We ain't playing with you. Jesus can't say, if Jesus wanted to be saved, he had to come to Joshua. You don't realize your Bible's been translated by man. You're believing man. You ain't believing Yahweh. I seen the oldest Bibles in the world. I seen this, the Vatican Library coming for myself. Now, have you done it? You done your research? Just do it. Then you'll find out what we're telling you is the truth. Look up the letter J. Then you don't say, hey, that white fool come down there, ain't got no hair on the back of his head, tell me all this junk. You check it out for yourself, you find out it's true.
That's right.
Because if I'm lying to you, my soul's going to be damned. That's Revelation 21:8. All liars shall depart in the lake of fire. And said the unbelieving and the fearful.
Mm-hmm.
and whoremongers and adulterers and idolaters and all liars. Now see, you're lying on his name. Now, when you did it in ignorance, Yahweh has mercy and grace for that.
Right.
But after it's, matter of fact, it's Matthew 12:31. It said, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven. Why? Because he's going to die for it. And he'll forgive the speaking against the Son of Man. That's when he's walking around the flesh and the Holy Spirit ain't poured out yet. He said the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven in this age, nor the one to come. Because he's poured out the Holy Spirit, and Yahshua is the name of the Holy Spirit. So when you say it's another name you can be saved in, you're blaspheming his name, saying you ain't giving it reverence. And you know what? They call the Pope, 1 billion Catholics call Pope Most Holy Father. Matthew 23:9 said, call no man father on earth. And you know what? Some people call their pastors reverend. It means the same thing. You're supposed to reverence him. Ha! So you don't know what's going on. You got to come to this school. And I didn't know what was going on until I come down here and found out. And then checked it out. See, it's my fault you ain't done the... you just can't read the Bible and figure it out on your own. You know how many people's tried to do that? It takes the one that wrote it to tell you. And that's what's going on down here. Matter of fact, we're going to show you a mystery, if Yahweh will. It ain't no preacher ever going to tell you. Matter of fact, we can go right here and do blood, water, spirit, and do all kinds of things from Genesis to Revelation. I don't know, what do you want to see? Anyway, you see, far above all principalities and powers and name that is named, not only in this age, but the one to come. See, that's all throughout eternity. We just went from eternity to eternity showing you Yahweh of salvation, just with the name. You're saved by grace through faith, that's Ephesians 2:8. It says from Titus 3:5, not by works of righteousness we have done, but by his mercy have he saved us. Saved by mercy. Romans 8:24, we're saved by hope. I could go to other places, the gospel of hope, you know, you got all them things in there. Then Romans 1:16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel inside. What is the gospel? See, people can quote things. They don't know what it is. Come on. What is the gospel? Okay, let's read it. 1 Corinthians 15, and we're going to preach it. We ain't just going to read it. So it says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel inside. Matter of fact, a guy in our class, he'd only been in class about a year. He said, you know, I'm in the Bible. Romans 1:16. I ain't ashamed of the gospel of Messiah. It's the power of Yahweh of the salvation of everybody. But you got to do this. Sometimes you have to bring that thing on to yourself. It ain't back there. I'm the same way. I ain't ashamed of the gospel of Messiah. For it's the power of Yahweh and the salvation of everyone that believes. Read.
Moreover, go ahead.
Moreover, brethren.
And I'll tell you, the gospel is one of the most written about things in the Bible, and it's the gospel of the kingdom. Matthew, that's really what's going on. There's a kingdom of eternal peace, joy, and happiness. And that's why the gospel of the kingdom has to be preached. That's how you get there. Take it. And Mark 16:15, after his death, burial, resurrection, he said, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Them that believe and are baptized shall be saved. Believe and are baptized by the Holy Spirit, not water, shall be saved. Them that believe not shall be damned. You don't believe the gospel, be damned. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name shall they cast out demons. Used to speak with other tongues. That's why we speak with other tongues. We don't speak like everybody. This is Holy Spirit now. You understand? And in his name, demons are cast out. That's what happened to us. It was the gospel preached in the name, the demons are cast out, and you receive the Holy Spirit. That's why Ephesians 1:13 said, after you trust in him, you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. After you believe, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit promise. You better know what the gospel is to get that, don't you? And so, in Revelation 14:8, 14:6, I saw an angel fly in the midst of heaven, having an everlasting gospel then preach on earth. That means it don't change.
Right.
Everlasting, don't change. And when it says he saw an angel fly in the midst of heaven, that means the Holy Spirit in you. That's in the midst. Mm-hmm. And the Holy Spirit's in heaven, ain't he? It ain't something flying around somewhere. Try to grab him and get the gospel. That ain't happening. You can't be Carl Meyer read that book. It's a revelation. So 1 Corinthians 15 tells you what it is.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel that I preach unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved.
You're saved, read.
If you keep in memory what I preached unto you.
Now how can you keep in memory if it never was preached to you?
Right.
Read.
Unless you have believed in vain.
Unless you believe in vain, unless you think it's something, don't mean nothing. Read.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that the Messiah died for our sins according to the Scripture.
He died according to Scripture, Genesis to Revelation. I mean, Genesis to Malachi. That was the Scriptures, because Matthew to Revelation wasn't written yet. Read.
And that he was buried.
He was buried.
And that he rose again the third day according to the Scripture.
He rose again the third day.
You can't do that with Jesus because you're waiting for a second coming. How'd he rise again? The third day.
Huh? Good question, ain't it?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll do a couple of them for you. Genesis was a vision Moses got. The first day he saw the earth without form and void. Death. Waters are covered over the earth, that's buried. Joshua said the Scriptures testify me. Paul says you got to see Joshua, how he died, buried, resurrected according to the Scriptures. So it's buried under the waters for the first and second day. The third day, the waters roll back. And the seed of vegetation come forth. Herb yielding seed after his kind. Tree yielding fruit after his kind. Now see, trees and plants don't have no flesh and blood. It's the first fruits. It's showing how he's going to die, bury, and resurrect, being the first fruits, and there ain't going to be no flesh and blood body. Mm-hmm. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's three other days left. So the man ain't come forth, so he's still in a death-like state. He's still buried on the fifth day, and on the sixth day he comes forth. That's a resurrection again, the third day. We have a tabernacle. You wonder why there's a lamb killed in the morning and one in the evening? Because death, burial, resurrection, third hour of the day, 9 o'clock, and through a 3-foot door. Then at 3 o'clock, there's a lamb killed, death, burial, resurrection again at 3 o'clock. Simple, ain't it? He came from pure spirit in those super incorporeal form. You read in the Bible that it's a lamb slain before the foundation
of
the
world.
How do you know that? Because this lamb was slain before Moses saw the vision, so that's a lamb slain before the foundation of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Also, they killed the lamb before he went up there and had the vision, because they gave him the covenant. The reason why the law was spoken first is because Yahweh is universal spirit law.
Mm-hmm.
People think that the law of the spirit of life happened on the day of Pentecost.
Oh no, it's been here since.
Right. Whatever you got runs from out eternity.
Mm-hmm.
See? And really, Yahshua already saved us from our sins. We just have to come to class and find out about it.
Very good.
He did that 2,000 years ago. You know what you're saved from now? The wrath of Yahweh.
That's right.
That's Romans 5 and 9. It's 1 Thessalonians 5 and 10, 1 and 10. And 1 Thessalonians 5 and 9. Check it out yourself. If we have time. But we got some other thing we running, right? Now, so here is a death. He buried himself in the creation and resurrected and gave it life.
Mm-hmm.
Death, burial, resurrection.
Yeah.
Okay? He came in. Well, look at Adam. It says in 1 Corinthians 15:21, in Adam all died. Mm-hmm. Or 15:22. In Adam all died, in Yahshua Messiah shall all be made alive. Now the fall of Adam begins a death.
Mm-hmm.
And you know school starts in the fall time, so school started when Adam fell.
That's right.
So that's a death. The flood comes, that's a burial. But you know what? Exactly 3 days, or 3,000 years, is when the temple resurrected. That's why in John 2:19 he said, tear this temple down, 3 days I raise up, because the 3,000 years when the temple resurrected. So really, this tabernacle has skin and hair. It's like when you walk around in a physical body. But the temple's showing forth you got a spiritual body coming. Also with the high priest, he had garments that were bloodstained, but he changed them to garments for beauty and glory, showing there's got to be a change in the body. Now, the Savior was back there with the children of Israel. That's a great mystery. He appears here at the age of 30. You understand? He's the one who gave Moses the vision and said, come now. He didn't say go.
Mm-hmm.
See, people sing that song. Go down, move. I can't sing very good. You understand? They'll let Will do that one. You understand? But he ain't say go down. He said come now, therefore, because he's down there. He said, I seen there. I seen their afflictions. People ain't teaching that nowhere. He the one that gives them the vision. That's why you see in Exodus 6:1, Yahweh speaking the most. 7:1, Yahweh speaking the most. 8:1, Yahweh speaking the most. 9:1, Yahweh speaking the most. 10:1, Yahweh speaking the most. 11:1, Yahweh speaking the most. 12:1 says Yahweh spoken to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, in a body called Joshua. But you don't read about it until 17:9. That's the first mention you read. That when they got in trouble, they got Moses appointed Joshua to fight Amalek. But Joshua the only one that can fight that opposition. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
So now he was 30 years down here. 40 years here, he was Moses' minister. What's this young man doing Moses' minister? He was 33 years old, ain't that a young man?
That's a young man.
See, that's instituting the back here. And he gonna fulfill it. That's why Moses had to die off. He died off of Mount Nebo. Every knee must bow, including Moses. They was all looking at Moses. Who took him over?
Joshua.
But ain't no Jay. Yahshua's the only one can take you over to the promised land. And he fought their battles for 40 years. Now, another thing what you see with the gospel, remember he said that in his name you're casting out demons? Death, burial, resurrection, third day, Pharaoh cast in the Red Sea. It's the gospel cast out demons. So after Moses died, he's buried, they resurrect through there, didn't he cast out them nations and give them their inheritance? Now see, this is the most holy place according to the pattern, so it's showing you that he's going to cast out demons in hearts, mind, and man.
That's right.
That's why he was cast seven out of Mary Magdalene. You know why? Dr. Kinley said the reason he cast seven demons out of Mary Magdalene is because he ain't going to appear to no satanic leader when he resurrects. And in Matthew 17:9, he told them, tell the vision no man until after the Son of Man resurrected again the third day. He even said he was going to die, buried, resurrect again. The whole world don't know that. You don't see them teaching that. They don't understand again. Mm. See, we're going to show you so many agains that you understand again.
Right.
So you got 30 here. 40 here, he died at 110 after he gave them their physical inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
He died at 110. They buried him. Didn't he come to the loins of Virgin Mary?
Mm-hmm.
That's him resurrecting from the dead.
Because
he was buried in the earth. What's a woman made from?
Earth.
That's him resurrecting from the dead. Then he lives for 33 years, fulfilling. He's on the cross, it is finished. See, he said, I have the power to lay it down. I have the power to take it up again. So when he comes to the Lord's Virgin Mary, that's him power to take it up again. And as Isaiah said, he's going to come as a tender plant. You would never think he'll come as a baby. You understand? He'll be like, you understand? Yahweh, he's past you finding out. And that's the creator of the body doing that. See, somebody say, I don't believe a virgin being impregnated. I can't see impregnate. That's what the Jews can't believe, that you can impregnate something without a man. But look what this creation did. He impregnated with all the trees.
Very
ain't
good.
No man do that.
Mm-hmm.
He impregnated with all the animals and everything else that exists. That's doing some impregnating, ain't it? A woman ain't nothing. You know what I'm talking about? Anyway. And that's why he can make a stone cold fool or something. I'm testifying to myself. Examine yourself. We was all wrong. Ain't nobody wrong more than the next one. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But at least you can admit it, hopefully. And he can do something with you then. Just like an alcoholic. You drunk, you want to blame everybody else. You're in denial. See, people are drunk off false doctrine. They're in denial. And people don't know what they're talking about. Well, come and find out. Find out. You ain't the one that don't know what they're talking about. See, come on down. You can't learn. Did you learn all you? Did you? You went to 12-year school. Did you learn everything?
Yeah.
No, we were stupid coming out of. I used to think my parents were stupid. I ain't listening to you. The next thing I found out, I was a stupid one. Wasn't then? We didn't know so much, did we? Anyway, so he lives 33 years. He dies, buries. He resurrected again. The third day. Even the prophets. You have the death of, you know, Daniel's good as dead. Thrown in the lion's den, that's a burial, and he resurrects. Jonah thrown into the fish belly, that's a death. He's buried, and he resurrects the third day. So that's all talking about his death, burial, resurrection.
Right.
Again. the third day. Now, this is where they all miss him at. They think that he ascended, and he gone and come back. He gonna come back one day. Jesus coming. Jesus coming. You better read Galatians 4 and 6. Read Colossians 1, 26, 27. Read Ephesians 4 and 3 and maybe 16. Try that. Give me 1 John 2, 27. Please. Well, I don't know. It depends. Oh, I bet. Well, anyway.
Well, the anointing which you have received of him abides in you, and you need not that any man teach you.
Okay, now she done went the last one I called. First, this 1 John 2, 27. The anointing which you have received, you don't need any man teach you. Read. Read.
But as the same anointing teaches you all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it has taught you, you shall abide in him.
In him, that's Joshua. Now, another thing is, you know, in Habakkuk 2 and 2, Lot didn't know but nothing about no Habakkuk.
Right.
It says, write the vision, make it plain upon tables. He may run and read it. For the vision yet for the point in time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. You were supposed to be looking for a vision at the end, speaking not lie. Mm. We didn't even know we should have a vision. You understand? Okay. That's how the Creator appears. And how you know that? Because Noah had a vision. It's going to rain. Saying things nobody ever heard. Preached 120 years, and 8 people were saved. You know what IDMR tell you now, you gotta have 10 people in class?
Yeah.
Noah couldn't even be a branch. And he preached 120 years. Now you know a man's all up in that. You got a man up in that where Noah can't be a branch. You at least ought to change it to 8. Anyway, down here, Joshua was given vision because he's a vision personified. He was speaking and not lying at the end of this age. So there have to be a man at the end of this age. Speaking, not lying, that's this vision revelation you are sitting under right now. To put the Bible in pictorial form and just and says there in Isaiah 35 and 8, a highway shall, you ain't gonna get no higher than this. Because Yahweh said in Isaiah 57, 15, I'm the high and not well. In as Isaiah 35 and 8, the highway shall be there, it shall be for the wayfaring man. A fool should not err therein. I'm a witness. A fool like me should couldn't err in. It's so simple. You understand? It's 1, 2, 3. You'll say, 1, 2, 3. He spake from a cloud. How's that? Because clouds threefold. You got the cirrus. They're the high and wispy ones without shape and form. The white ones. Wispy only. Then the ones that take on shape and form are the intermediate. They're the alto cumulus. They're gray and white, but they take on shape and form.
Right.
And then you got the stratus touching the ground. Came down there. Still one cloud, eh? Still these three are one. Okay. What you don't realize is there's a cloud that led the children of Israel out. There's a cloud that gave, where the cloud was the meeting place where he had the vision.
Right.
You understand? Mm-hmm. See, there's a cloud that covered this tabernacle, and the glory filled it. Moses couldn't go in. Ain't no flesh after that cloud fills it. Then over here, same thing in 1 Kings 8 and 10, cloud covered, the glory filled it. See, and there's a bright cloud overshadowed him when he had the vision there. Yahshua died, died, buried, resurrected, ascended. He ascended up into a cloud, said he'll come back in like man. He did, came back in their cloud, and that's how he deals.
Mm-hmm.
And you, with spermatozoa, like in a cloud, that was your beginning place. You have to bring your cloud down here and get it preached into.
Very good.
You understand? So you can have a Shekinah. See, when you have preached the death, burial, resurrection, ascension, Shekinah, light comes on, darkness gone. You understand? That's the Holy Spirit in you. You understand? You've been enlightened. That's Yahshua Messiah. So when he died, buried, resurrected again the third day, he ascended. And when he poured out the Holy Spirit, that's him resurrecting again. He resurrected 120 on the day of Pentecost. They preached the gospel. 3,000 were out that day. That's him resurrecting again. He's in man's mind. 7 years he was resurrecting through the Jews only. And then the Gentiles, he's resurrecting again. See, and what's it? And he can resurrect again right in your heart and mind.
Very good.
See, it ain't leaving you out. That's what soul salvation is about. That's what Colossians 1, 26, 27 said. Even the mystery which is hidden ages, generations, but now in man manifest to his son, that Yahshua the Messiah in you is your Holy Ghost. Now, how can he be in me and he's going to be coming back? He's supposed to be in you. How's he coming back? He's supposed to be in you. Great mystery, eh? And then when you go to Ephesians 3 and about 16, it says that he might strengthen you by his spirit in the inner man. That's the Holy Spirit resurrecting your soul. He says that the Messiah may dwell in your hearts by faith. I thought you said he's coming back. How can he dwell in the heart? And this is really the heart he's willing, man. Because he's the one speaking to you. You understand? In Galatians 4 and 6 says we have the adoption of son. Because he had put the spirit of his son in your heart. That's Joshua, ain't it? See, we're proving what we say. We don't play with you. You come back and hear more. You understand? And you're going to hear more. This thing don't stop. We're talking about, and see what happens is, the gospel is this, that if you have the Holy Spirit when you die, you got a mortal glorified body coming. You understand? And the resurrection from the dead. We didn't know these things, so we were dead. Now we do know them. We're alive. You were resurrected from the dead, just sitting in your seat.
That's right.
Having the gospel Messiah preached unto you. The Holy Spirit was preaching unto you. Then you received the self-same spirit and teaching the self-same thing. We ain't saying nothing different than what the brethren already taught you down here. Because it's a unity of the Spirit. We clear 4,000, you know, so many thousand miles away. But the Holy Spirit is the same Spirit teaching the same thing. Mm-hmm. You understand? See? And that's what will take us all over into the next age.
Yeah.
We're going to have it. See, this age has to end. Why? Because this is the fourth age. He's got 5, 6, and 7 coming.
Yeah.
You understand? Mm-hmm. And this one has to end. The reason they don't... Anyway. And we're going to take on a mortal glorified body. That's what Ephesians 3:21 said. He shall change our vile body into one like in his glorious body.
Uh-huh.
We got a glorious body coming. This is a physical body. You're going to get a spirit body to be him throughout eternity. Your physical life is this long.
That's right.
Yeah. Eternal life. So I tell you what. You say, I can't change. I've been tied to Jesus all my life. Well, I tell you what. Eternity is a lot longer than your belief. And your life. And Moses was 80 years old when he got the name. Never too late to learn. So this is the greatest teaching in the world. Come back and get some more of it. It's real. We ain't playing with you. You understand? Because this is nothing to play with. See, and it's the greatest teaching you'll ever have in your life. And this thing, something happened to us, we come down here and we ain't stopping. So all praise go to Yahweh Elohim through his son, Yahshua Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Terry Welsh, Dean of Lansing, Michigan, member of Northern Regional Dean's Committee.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Very, very glad to be here. Glad to see all of you. To sense the spirit that's here. You enjoy class so far?
Oh, yeah.
Definitely. Absolutely. Because it was the truth. Came from Yahweh, who has revealed himself unto us. You know, the teaching that we're blessed to be part of is, as the moderator said, a result of the vision that the Creator himself gave directly to Dr. Kinley in our day, in other words, in our dispensation down here at this time, which is the same identical vision that was given to Moses, the first Bible writer. It's identically the same vision that was given to the last Bible writer, the Apostle John, and the other writers, you know, like the prophets and so forth in between. And we are blessed to receive this vision visually. In other words, if you look here, see these charts? You can see them, can't you?
Okay.
Well, what's on the charts is basically the same thing that's written in the Bible, in words, okay? Now, when those men that wrote the Bible received those visions, Yahweh had them write them down in words. Let me ask you a question. Can you read the words and figure out what Yahweh really was trying to express? Or, I mean, is reading those words enough to figure it out and get it right? It isn't. That's obvious. There's... What is the count today? The number of different denominations and sects and whatever that all say we believe in the Bible.
Right.
Okay? The Bible is not enough. Okay? Just like the way you and I learn things, okay? We have to have some really direct experience with it if we're going to be skilled in it. Okay? In other words, there's a difference between education and training. Okay? I do training for a career. I train in occupational safety areas, including CPR and other kinds of things like this. Education basically gives people a lot of information, okay? And they put that in their head, okay?
Right.
But training requires that you put that knowledge into practice.
Right.
That's right. That you be able to, in other words, to translate that knowledge down into a level where you can apply it,
right.
Okay? And so you have to have personal experience with it, okay? Now, what you get here by looking at the charts and having someone that understands it, I'm talking about really the Holy Spirit in someone that has revealed to them part of what Yahweh has shown to Dr. Kinley, Moses, and John, and all those others, okay? You get a chance to actually see it with your eyes, okay? You get a chance to hear it with your ears, and you can confirm it by reading it in the scriptures to make sure that what you've been shown and what you've been told is actually correct, okay? You don't read the Bible to get a revelation.
Right.
You read the Bible to get a confirmation of what's already been taught, okay? Now, we therefore are so blessed to be able to employ this vision, okay? And it is unique. There is something, you know, somebody can say, well, you know, shoot, I could write pictures about what's in the Bible. Some Bibles have pictures, don't they?
Yeah.
Okay? And you see these little pictures, there's somebody's portrayal about Jesus somewhere, and they show a little halo around his head and all that kind of stuff. And you know those pictures are garbage? I hate to say it, I don't mean to be overly critical, but the truth of the matter is the halo over his head was a depiction of a pagan god. Pagan god had that halo. That was showing the circle of the sun, of the sun god in the myths, okay? That's not the way it was, okay? These pictures are laid down by a single uniform pattern that doesn't change.
That's right.
That can be proven and that you can experience once your mind has been trained, I mean really trained, to experience and see how this pattern operates, because you take this same pattern and you go out there in the world, and I don't care what you do, this pattern will operate in your life. And then you can experience it personally and individually. And I'm going to give you a little introduction to this basic idea. And most of you probably know this, okay? But still, it's worth going over again, okay? Now, when Yahweh took Moses up to give him this vision, it's already been stated, he appeared to Moses in this type of a form here, which is a man-like form. Dr. Kinley used the word anthropomorphic, which means in the form of a man, okay? He also called it super incorporeal, or super incorporeal, whatever you want to pronounce it. But the point is, the body was beyond the body of an angel. And it certainly was way above that which is fleshly or physical. Okay? All right. Now, Moses did not understand him when he saw him like that. Okay? He was, like, impressed. It's like, wow. But you know, you can go, wow, and not understand it, okay? So what Yahweh had to do to get Moses to relate with what Yahweh had already shown him, which is himself. Now let me point something out. What does it say here? Vision of
Elohim
in a corporeal form. Now, this says to Moses, it's a panoramic vision of
Elohim
to Moses. Now let's go over here. This is number three. Two, three witnesses, panoramic vision of Elohim to John, okay? Now, did it say that this is a vision of the creation?
No.
Didn't say that, right? Did it say it was a vision of angels?
No.
No, okay? In other words, my point is that his point is it's about him.
Right.
The vision is of him. But the things in the creation, angels, everything testifies to him or has a representation of him. But and the world knows this. Every culture has this in there. They go out and they meditate in the beautiful landscape. I mean, every time I come out west, I am awed. I love the mountains.
I mean, the mountains are majestic. And the rock formations and the different flora and fauna and the different, you know, just, it's absolutely amazing. And you look out there, and I am really awed. And my background was in the sciences. And when I was in the sciences, I really ended up being belittled completely by the most elite in the research field. Because they said that I was absolutely stupid to believe in a creator, because after all, science has proven that everything has come about by evolution. You know, there's no God, there's no, and it, that is the most stupid. All you got to do is look in your creation and look at the absolute infinite permutations and combinations of things that there are, and they all fit together. Right. You go into all those different types of areas. I mean, we've been down in Texas, Arizona, you know what I'm saying? You come through and you go all the way north and all those different things, and guess what? There's so many different types of living things there. And they just, for some reason, wherever you are, the ones that are there work together in a balance, in harmony, okay? And yet every single one of them, I don't care how many are there, where they're at, all have their same basic life structure and function by the one pattern, proving scientifically they came from one source in one substance. And it is a mathematical impossibility for all of those things to have occurred by random chance without an imposed order or a pattern. And I'm talking about a scientist. Really, when you look at it, any scientist that's not absolutely foolish can't deny what I just said. But they want to be gods instead of letting Yahweh be the creator. Mm-hmm. Follow me? So they got to deny him. Anyway, I'm awed by that, and it's impressive. And in all the cultures, you recognize those things, and they get out and they meditate, you know, and they try to get closer, you know, to the spirit and so forth. But folks, you have been given a method is direct and that isn't flawed by your concept that takes place when you meditate on nothingness. Okay? Well, the whole idea behind meditation is to empty your mind and then to completely let your mind just free flow, okay, and have a sense internally of union with that which is greater than you. And I'm saying there's nothing wrong with doing that, but when you come back from that, if you can't explain and show somebody else what it was, what you had was a good feeling, but it was not a revelation. And Yahweh has given us a revelation of himself by this pattern.
That's right.
And the pattern is the key. And that's what I'm trying to get at, to get you to really appreciate this pattern. So Moses was awed by Yahweh Elohim when he saw him, just like I'm awed by the creation when I look at that. You follow me? But the fact that I'm awed by it doesn't mean I understand it or really know anything about it. Right? I'm just awed. So what Yahweh Elohim did in this vision to Moses was he transformed from that threefold supreme spirit embodiment in front of Moses into a threefold, fully furnished, intangible tabernacle pattern, with the tabernacle pattern being the explanation of who he is.
That's right.
Now, who he is the Word or the Son of Yahweh the Father. Or in other words, a word is an expression, right?
Very good.
This is Yahweh or Spirit expressed. Mm-hmm. This is Yahweh or Spirit represented by the cloud in a state that is beyond expression. Incomprehensible, inscrutable, inexpressible in that state. So what he did was he simply expressed himself as the Word. But every word to be understood requires a definition. And this pattern is the definition of the word. And then he showed Moses how that he, the word, the son, the original pattern, archetype pattern, created everything in the world. You see how each of these little pieces of the creation vision are in a pattern? That's showing how he created everything by himself, who is the archetype or the original pattern. So everything in the creation is really an example of him, right? So what he had was the word, the definition of the word, and multiple examples of word usage, right? This is the ultimate use of etymology, right?
Yeah.
Because etymology is the study of word origins, tracing it back to their original words and meaning, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Now, there is no word that is before him.
Uh-oh.
He is the original. It says right here, archetype meaning original pattern, right? So the ultimate etymology is to trace it all to him, okay? And that is where the whole thing is. If we see him, we have a revelation or a genuine understanding of what it's all about or what's important, okay? You know, Dr. Kinley, the founder, dealt with etymology a lot. He did an awful lot with etymology because, the creator, that intelligence in him, had used etymology in all the visions. Follow me? Now, so the word, however, or the pattern, however, is the thing which makes the understanding of him linkable to or relatable to the things in the physical. So that you can take the physical expressions or examples of word usage and understand him without going, well, I think it means this, I think it means that. No, you've already got a structure. You've got an organization, an order within which you can see the analysis, the breakdown, the whole makeup of the things in the creation representing the makeup of the creator.
That's right.
That made the things in the creation. Then Yahweh went to the extent of having Moses build a physical tabernacle exactly like the one in the mountain. So this would be an everlasting witness, or on record, in other words, of him. That's why they called this the tabernacle of witness. Now, really, this tabernacle, again, is only representing who? Him, Yahweh Elohim. And really, who was Yahshua? That was Yahweh Elohim manifest, right? And that's why he is called the faithful and the true witness, because the tabernacle represented him, and that was a tabernacle of witness.
Right.
See? Okay? So he is the real witness. And when he came in the world, he was the one in whom the Spirit dwelt in fulfillment or reality, because that's what fulfillment means, right? In fulfillment or reality means many things, including reality, okay? In the fulfillment or reality of this tabernacle back here. Because when this tabernacle was made, Yahweh told Moses the purpose for it. He said, let them make me a sanctuary. For what reason? That I may dwell among them, right? Okay? So this was Yahweh's house. Well, folks, he didn't live in this house forever. When this body was made and raised up, this was the house of Yahweh. Follow me?
Mm-hmm.
And this was the important one, because that one was a witness of this one.
Very good.
All right.
Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay? Now, two different ways I'd like to go on this. I'm not going to get time for all of it. All right, I will do it this way. I will do it like this, okay? Now, where was Yahweh's seat in that house? The Ark of the Covenant in the most holy place, right? Represented right here. This is where the cloud was shown. And the cloud symbolizes spirit. And there's a little more to that. I want to mention something, not going into details. The cloud symbolizes eternity, which is the domain or dwelling place of Yahweh or Spirit, right? Okay? We use the cloud to represent Yahweh or Spirit because Yahweh showed himself here dwelling in a cloud, okay? And a cloud is abstract in that you can't see things, but it is able to take on shape and form, okay? So we could use the cloud as representing Spirit, which is right. We also use the cloud as representing eternity, okay? Which is the dwelling place or the domain of Yahweh, okay? Now, so my point here was, this most holy place, Ark of the Covenant, was the seat or the center of the presence of Yahweh dwelling in this house, okay? All right? And of course, you all know that that is represented in your body by the fact that you have a brain here. Well, I think you have a brain. Everybody here have a brain?
Yeah.
All right? Yeah, somebody says it's questionable. And we joke about that, right? But you see, and I bring this up not to be in jest. Everybody believes they got a brain, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But other people say, I don't believe there's a God. I ain't never seen him. I don't believe nothing I don't see. You believe you got a brain?
You ain't seen it.
You never seen it and never will. In fact, let me say something. Believe it or not, you've never seen your face.
That's right.
That's right.
That's there.
You've seen reflections of your face. That's right. And a whole creation has reflections of the Creator. Well, you believe you got a face when you see its reflection. You should believe you got a Creator when you see His reflection.
Yes. Right.
You can see pictures of your face, but you won't see your face.
That's true.
Well, the creation has pictures of the Creator. But, you know, people don't think like this. You know, they don't think like this because they haven't seen and understood it. Once you feel it, experience it, and it becomes real with you, you really can't think no other way.
That's right.
Okay? All right, now, so here he is dwelling here in the most holy place, okay? And that's showing the presence of Yahweh like the presence that he has in you as his tabernacle now, okay? Now, so keep in mind, the tabernacle is the tabernacle, which is his house. The presence is here. Seat is here on the Ark of the Covenant, the most holy place. But do you know that Ark of the Covenant was not always in the tabernacle? There was a time that that Ark of the Covenant was not in the tabernacle.
That's right.
Do you know that that whole tabernacle was not built and finished for 9 months? Just like a physical body doesn't get built and finished for 9 months, right? And then the spirit moves into the tabernacle, into the body. You follow me? Just like after the 9 months of construction, then the spirit of Yahweh moved into here, it says the glory of Yahweh descended, okay? The cloud represented that, okay? And filled the tabernacle, just like fills a baby, okay? Now, but the Ark of the Covenant was there in existence before it was in the tabernacle for those 9 months. But you know, they didn't put that Ark of the Covenant just set out in the outside. Just, hey, well, let's build an Ark of the Covenant and set it outdoors. Where was it? Where was it? I heard somebody say something. Joshua's tent or Yahshua's tent. Right? Now watch this, okay? Follow this down. You see this little tent back here? You see this little white tent back here with the cloud over it? On the back side of Mount Sinai, right next to where the burning bush is? Okay, that really, now we can't draw two things on a flat surface in the same place. Where that burning bush was, and that's where Joshua's tent was. Mm-hmm. And that was on the backside of Mount Sinai. And the cloud is over that tent, which is the same cloud that's up here, which is the same cloud that later was in the most holy place and hovering over the tabernacle. You see it right here. But before the Ark of the Covenant was in here, it was out here. Now when I say out here, what I'm talking about is it was outside their camp. You see, once the tabernacle was finished, what the people had to do was get in order. Okay? It was the center of their order, of their organization, of their life. They had to camp. Three specific tribes on this side, three specific tribes on that side, three specific tribes on this side, three specific tribes on the other side, with the Levites in around the tabernacle. So you had a threefold camp. You had the tribes, the Levites, and the tabernacle.
Very good.
Right? That's representing the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit in one embodiment. Now it's just threefold. Okay? And the tabernacle was right in the midst of them. So when he told Moses, let them make me a sanctuary that I might dwell among them. Okay? He wasn't just saying I might dwell in the same general area. I'm in them. In their midst. Okay? Follow me? But before he was in their midst, he was not in their midst. Now, he was with them, but not in them. Because the tent of Yahshua with the ark was with Israel in the wilderness, but not in the camp. It was outside the camp.
That's correct.
It was on the mountain. Not way up on the peak, but it was on the backside of the mountain, because that's where Joshua's tent was pitched, which was where the burning bush was. That's where the presence of Yahweh was, okay? What does that show in the larger picture? It simply shows that in Yahweh's purpose, as it progresses on down through time, okay? And listen, Yahweh's purpose makes progress, but it doesn't change who Yahweh is, okay? It simply unfolds and further reveals who he is, okay, as it continues on. Look, all this time before this part you see with the cross, okay, all these ages here, okay, the Spirit of Yahweh is in the world. He is with his people, okay? But the Holy Spirit, which is Yahweh's Spirit, people talk about pure spirit. Spirit, pure means holy, okay? Mm-hmm. So one expression or definition of pure spirit can mean Holy Spirit. Okay? The point is, the Holy Spirit was with his people in the world, but the Holy Spirit was not yet given as a gift and did not dwell in them as a permanent place.
That's right.
So before he was in us, he was with us, but he was not in us because he was pitched outside us or our camp. Do you follow me? You understand the analogy?
Yeah.
Okay? All right, now, this gets into the mystery of this Joshua called Yahshua. Because the Ark of the Covenant had to be in somebody's tent. And only one person's tent. Right? Mm-hmm. And that was the one whose ark or throne it was. Because that's what the Ark of the Covenant was the throne of Yahweh. Okay? And this was Joshua's or Yahshua's tent. Now, so my point is this, that before this man came in the world to fulfill, he was in the world instituting. This was Yahweh in a body. And the scripture doesn't say, you can look this up, Colossians 2:9. Does not say he was the fullness of the Godhead in a body. says he was all
yeah.
the fullness of the Godhead in a body, or bodily, okay? Okay? Just something to think about, okay? So before he was here, the creator, in a body, and Dr. Kinney put it this way. He said, that's all the God that there was.
Mm-hmm.
He said, that's all the God that there was in that body, okay? So what I'm saying is, before that time, this is the fulfillment of it, in the institution, that was all the God that there was in that body with the same name. And he already showed you how he was born from eternity, and you name him when he's born, right? Says he was the firstborn of every creature. Says he was the beginning of the creation of Yahweh. Now, he didn't go nameless for all that time, up for 4,000 years later, and then Yahweh said, oops, forgot to name my son. Let me now call him Yahshua for 33 years, and then you can name him something different later. You with me on this? You understand what I'm trying to get at? His name was back here in eternity, and that's why the angel said, you shall call his name Yahshua, for he shall save his people from his sins, because he already had that name. He didn't say, Joseph, you name him Yahshua. His name already was Yahshua. Yahweh, his true father, gave him his name. But Joseph, his physical manifest as father, was the one who had to call that name out for the record. Okay? Because he already had the name. So his name wasn't just for 33 years. It's right. Eternal. In existence, eternal. Now, so this was him. Creator of the body, in the fulfillment. This was him, Yahshua, same name, creator of the body, instituting, setting it up, okay? And look, the spirit of Yahweh, represented by this cloud, okay? And his throne, representing his kingdom, that was in Joshua's tent. And the tent is like a body. That's what a tent, in fact, that's what a tabernacle means.
Right.
Means tent, okay? So now I gotta get a couple of scriptures real quick to give you scriptural manifestation that this was Yahweh. Now, I'm gonna let y'all get the ones in another class that you typically get in the book of Exodus, okay? So a bunch of them in the book of Exodus show about Joshua, son of Nun, and so forth, okay? Being in places that the only one that had a right to be there was Yahweh himself. But get me four scriptures in Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 1, you might have to help me out, I'm no bibliomaniac, and I'm not a bibliobrainiac, like my good brother over here, okay? Give me Deuteronomy 1, I think it's 28, I believe it is. Deuteronomy, now I'm going to draw a blank. What's that?
Where shall we go?
Deuteronomy 1:38, Deuteronomy 3:28, Deuteronomy 9:3, and Deuteronomy 31 and 3. Believe that.
38. But Joshua, the son of Nun.
No, this is Deuteronomy what? 1?
1 and 38.
138, yes.
But Joshua, the son of Nun, which standeth before thee, he shall go in hither. Encourage him, for he shall cause Israel to inherit it.
Wait a minute. Who is going to cause Israel to inherit the promise?
Joshua.
Says Joshua the son of Nun, right? Okay? So Yahweh, the creator, is telling Moses here, that's what you're reading. Yahweh telling Moses, I don't think Yahweh was lying. And I don't think Yahweh's changing his story. Later on, oh, changed my mind. Okay? So Yahweh tells Moses, Joshua the son of Nun will cause Israel to inherit the promise. Now you just think about that. That ought to be enough right there to realize Joshua the son of Nun was no ordinary man. And to realize that when it comes to what it symbolizes, inheriting the promise of eternal life, there is no one can cause you to inherit that except Yahshua.
Right.
Or Joshua, who is Yahshua. But he says Joshua caused him to inherit it. Deuteronomy 3:28, please.
But charge Joshua and encourage him and strengthen him, for he shall go over before this people, and he shall call them to inherit the land which thou shalt see.
Now Yahweh said it again. So now there's a difference between saying something once and repeating it with an emphasis. In other words, look, somebody can say something, okay, And that may not have been what they, what you heard them say, even though they said those exact words, what you heard them say about it may not have been their point. So if somebody says something once, don't take that and just run off with it. But if somebody repeatedly says the same thing in a similar context and emphasizes it, what they're doing is trying to get a message across. Now, Dr. Kinley said a lot of things. You follow me? But let me say this. When he repeatedly says the same thing, points it out, emphasizes it, he's not just saying it, he's teaching it. So don't tell me what Dr. Kinley said, show me what he taught. You follow me? All right. So Yahweh's teaching Joshua will cause him to inherit the land. Okay? Now, if you go back in Exodus, see there's scriptures in Exodus 13:21, 14:20, so forth, where he says the angel with the name of Yahweh in him, which is Joshua, right? The angel will go before them and cause them or to inherit the land or bring them into the land. Okay? And the angel that first appeared to Moses here at the burning bush announced his identity, I'm Yahweh. And Joshua was Yahweh. That was the angel. Joshua. But now here he says, Joshua's, all right, now go on to 9:3. Chapter 9, verse 3. Chapter 31, verse 3. Please read.
Understand, therefore, this day that Yahweh the Elohim is he which goeth over before thee. As a consuming fire, he shall destroy them, and he shall bring them down before thy face, so shalt thou drive them out.
Now, wait a minute. He's already said twice, Joshua's going to do this. He's going over before him. He's going to drive out the nations. He's going to cause them to inherit the land. Now he says, understand something. Read it again. He says, understand this.
Understand, therefore, this day, that Yahweh the Elohim is he which goeth over before thee.
Now he's already twice said Joshua's doing this.
Right.
But now he says, understand, it's Yahweh doing it. Make sense?
Uh-huh.
Now go to chapter 31, verse 3.
31:3. And I have filled him with the spirit of Elohim.
Now, he's talking about Joshua. Okay? So he says, I have filled him with the spirit of Elohim. That's who was in the tabernacle. That's who was in this body here. Right, go ahead.
In wisdom and in understanding?
Numbers 27. You're reading Numbers. Is that Deuteronomy? I knew there was something there. But it still does apply to Yahshua. I want Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 3.
Yahweh thy Elohim, he will go over before thee.
Now, there you go. He's saying the same thing we read in Deuteronomy 9:3. Yahweh your Elohim shall go over before you. Go ahead.
And he will destroy these nations.
He will destroy the nations. Now that was Joshua, man. Right. He was leading them in battle. They said he went through there, he never even got a scratch. Okay? Please read.
And he will destroy these nations from before thee.
Yes.
Thou shalt possess them. And Joshua, he shall go over before thee.
Oh, wait a minute. Now do you see this? Mm-hmm. Yahweh's going to go over before you and do this. Joshua is going to go over before you and do this. Now, without just breaking open the mystery before, I mean, without just coming right out and saying, Yahweh was Joshua. Joshua was Yahweh. Because the mystery had to be hidden. Because otherwise, when he came in down here with the same name, all the other things, they'd have never crucified him. They'd have been way too scared to put him on the cross, and he had to go to the cross, right?
Right.
So that's why he said this mystery was hidden from ages and from generations, but now it's made manifest to the sons. But it says, if they had known who the King of Glory was, they wouldn't have crucified him, right?
Right.
But he said, same verse, all through this thing, Joshua's going over for you, I'm going to cause you to inherit the promise. Joshua's going over before you, you're going to drive them out. Understand, Yahweh's going to do this, right? Now he goes over here and says, now Joshua's going to do it. Yahweh's going to do it. He's got a message. He's repeating this. He's emphasizing it. That had to be, I'm talking about Joshua, Yahshua. That had to be Yahweh the Creator in that body, causing them to inherit the land. It was his tent where the Ark of the Covenant was, okay? Because that was that Ark of the Covenant. That was his throne, okay? So, and there's more. I mean, you can go through a lot more with Joshua, okay? Or Yahshua, okay? But I hope you understand the point here. Yahweh the Creator was not up in the sky, off somewhere distant. Yahweh was with them even before he was in them. You follow me? And the same has happened with him all the way on down through the ages and the dispensations. Same is true with you. He was with you before he was in you. And now if you understand him, if he has revealed himself like he really is, by the pattern, he's not just with you. He's in you. So hope that's of some value. Thank you.